man, I don't know which way to go. I don't know which way to turn. You know, you hear some older saints that used to use that phrase, which way to turn? I go, well, I know which way to turn, because Jesus says, I am the way,
yes,
the truth, and the life.
Yeah.
And I love what Jesus said. He said, come follow me.
Yes.
Well, if you're following somebody, they're walking in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes we think of, well, God, you don't understand. You don't understand. Well, man, he created you. Let me tell you. He may, you know, that's what I love about God, is that, you know what? He don't give up on us.
No, he doesn't.
You know, and he bears with us. Now, I teach school, so as I teach, I understand that. We go from zero all the way up. I mean, I teach truck driving, and you have to learn the basics. I mean, how to start the truck up.
Yeah.
Can't just get in and let him go. But we walk beside him. We're with him every single step.
Yes.
You know, we're not going to just like, well, you just figure it out. Well, God gave us a manual.
Yes.
So in this life,
yes,
we wouldn't have to just figure it out.
Yeah.
What do you think this is?
Yeah.
This is the word of God.
Yeah.
He left us a manual. When I lived down in Mount Pleasant, one of the greeters, he'd always have some little nugget every time I went in the store. He'd say, you know what, you know, Tim, you know what Bible stands for? I said, well, you know, it's the word of God. He said, no, you know, the words, the letters, B-I-B-L-E. And I thought, well, no, where are you getting it? He says, Bible means basic instruction before leaving earth. That's what it means. Wow, I got to remember. I thought that was pretty good. Instruction,
yes,
tell you how to live, because that's one thing. When Jesus,
yeah,
comes to your heart, he changes your desires, your want to.
Yes.
Now they're flipped around. You want to do what God asks you to do. And I'm going to take a look at this scripture here. This is going to be in Exodus, because, you know, we look at Moses and we revere him because he did follow God, but he had some things going on.
Oh.
And when God called him, I'm always amazed that this is Exodus chapter 4. I'm always amazed at the call, because one thing about it is that we know how Moses started, you know, being a baby lost in the basket. You know, we all know that part. But when he tried to do it God's way, then he had to leave Egypt, you know, and he went on the backside of the desert. And it was 40 years before we look at the Bible as they heard from God. But you know, Moses was talking to God those 40 years, and I'm sure he was thinking, man, God, you know, I screwed up your plan. That wasn't the way. I know your mom, my mom, who raised Moses, you know, there for those years, so he went back to Pharaoh. You know, I'm sure his mom said, Alan, you know, you're a special child. God saved you for a reason. That's what you ought to tell your kids. Tell them something positive, that God's got a plan for your life.
Yeah.
You know, it just always aggravates the parents call their kids bad nickname. Like, you're never going to amount to nothing. Well, you know what? I deal with some individuals that have had that said to them.
Yeah.
You know, that they're never going to amount. Now they're 40 and 50 years old. That buzzes around their head. Wouldn't it be better to put some good things in their head and mind,
right,
that you're going to accomplish something?
Right.
That's what you ought to tell people.
Yes.
That God has a plan.
Yes.
God has a reason that you were on this earth. You didn't just come out here for no reason. There's a reason for your life. And that life is to serve God, to give it back to God, give your life and dedicate. I love when kids get dedicated. Both my daughters, they got dedicated to the Lord. And I remember that time when they got dedicated, the preacher said, okay, dedication your kids to the Lord, to me, is one part of it. The other part is you, the parent, need to stay dedicated to the Lord. It's a balance there. You need to be an example of how they should live.
Yes.
See, some people don't like doing that. Dwight Stone, he was a high jumper in the Olympics, and he said he always liked to go first. Well, I always thought, well, it'd be better to go last, because then you know what you had to beat to win.
Right.
He said, no, I like to set the standard.
Yeah.
I like them to catch me. I like the example. I said, wow, Jesus came to set the standard.
Yes.
Jesus was our example to live. Well, I don't know if I can live holy. Jesus was able to live holy. You have that power of the Holy Spirit inside of you. I can do this.
Yes.
When I come to those, when we get tempted like that, the thing was, we go to the Lord. We go to the Lord. Every time we have those thoughts come in, no, every subjection, all those thoughts are going to be subjected to the Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So you know, we used to say that WWJD, like, what would Jesus do? It's more than that, what would Jesus say? You know, how tell them to go to Pharaoh and let the people go. You're going to send me? And this is so I see this. Moses said that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt. But look what God said in response. Yeah, Moses, I'm going to use you. That's what I chose. I'm you. All those years haven't been in vain. I'm still working on you. I had to get out of things out of your life that shouldn't have been there. I want to get you totally dedicated. And God said, I will surely be with you.
Yes.
Oh, that's good, man.
Yeah.
And God's not a respecter of persons, so it's not just Moses, that's right.
That's right.
He said, I will surely. When God says surely, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
I say, I will surely be with you, and this will be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you should serve God on this mountain, Mount Horeb of Sinai. Now, what I'm going to look at, this next couple of verses, I want to look at. And Moses said to God, behold, when I come to Israel, say to them, the God of your fathers sent me to you. And they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am.
Yes.
I love that.
Yep.
I am that. I don't need a name. Just tell them I am.
Yeah.
God, I am. Past, present, future, I am. I'm right here. I'm with you. I'm past, present, future. I've always been God. forsaken or received baked bread. Amen. I remember getting that back clear back in 79. Woo. And I remember thinking, never seen the righteous forsaken. In all those 70 years.
Yeah.
And he's not. He's not going to forsake. And a lot of times we look, well, you know, it seems like things are going pretty slow. It doesn't mean God's not working.
That's right.
You know, you can't see the internal workings of an engine just by looking at it, right?
That's
you
right.
know whether the car's running or not, it's going forward.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what we got to look at. God's still working, especially when it deals with relationship. You know, he's not just working on one side. He's working on the other side to work all those things. That's what the Bible said. All these things. You know, God's working all these things together for good.
Right.
Those that love God.
Amen.
You know, just
Amen.
Because he's silent, it doesn't mean he's not. And that's what we got to get to. Because sometimes we think, man, I haven't heard. I said, but Dave's exactly right. We need to look for God every day.
Yes.
We need to think about what God means to us every day. I tell you what, I love to get up in the morning. I said this before. I don't really need to get up at 4:15 every morning. I don't have to be at work at 7:30. But I like to get up early because everything's quiet. And you can spend that time with God. And the day goes a lot better when you just reverence him. Get that quietness. God, what do you want me to do today? Let me be a light to you. Let my attitude be right. It's amazing how the day goes. probably a couple years ago, when I teach class, I like going there and being there early. And I tell you what, you can get the right spirit and everything in the classroom. And it's amazing how different the class flows. Absolutely. When you're in there and you let God tell, hey, God, this is not my classroom. This is your classroom. Because you brought all these people together this point in time for a reason. And that reason is a lot bigger than what we're doing here today. Because you don't know what life you're changing or touching. Because we don't know. You ever wonder why you were born at this time to come in this time? Why you were at this point in time in history? So you could have been born in the 1800s, right? But why are we at this point? Because God has a purpose, and he wants you to be a light wherever you're going. Whether that's at the grocery store, mail room, wherever you're at, he can use you. And he can use you in a mighty way. I tell you what, just to say, hey, I'm praying for you, how powerful that is in a person's life. If you know they're going through something, you know, just say, I'm standing with you, man. You know, I see you're kind of sad today. What's going on? You know, hey, Tim, would you pray for me? And one thing about praying for, I'm not going to tell somebody I'm going to pray for them and then not do it.
Amen.
You might as well lie to them because that's what you did. No, I said, no, you say pray, I'm going to pray, and I have to write stuff down, I remember. But they love those prayers. And then you ask them, it made a difference. It made a difference. Prayer does make a difference.
Amen.
Someone else. Yes, Mark.
I'm glad Sunday.
That's right.
You know, and I found myself in that situation, and I'm just like, I hadn't heard from my sons in 2 or 3 weeks, and, you know, I'm like, what's going on? And, you know, why am I here? What is your purpose for me, Lord? I mean, you have blessed me over the past 3 years, but I know there's something more.
Amen.
I know that you have more for me.
Amen.
Because I have the world in my vehicle a lot of times, to and from the airport. And, you know, he said, you know, I always just hate to say, you know, just hang in there.
That's right.
Hang in there. You know, it's just like, Lord, I just want to see what you're doing.
Yes.
You know, I just want to experience your love.
Amen.
And he says, we talked and we cried.
cross. You know, I had a preacher, he used to say, you know, Jesus hung up for all of our hang-ups. And I just remember that. And all the things we're going through, you know, God's been there and been through them. And he understands. That's one thing I love about Jesus, is he understands what you're going through.
Amen.
You know, one thing, the years I've been driving, one thing, it doesn't make you an expert. But what happens is, you know what works and what doesn't work. You've been doing it for 40 years. You know that this is, if you do this, this is going to happen.
Yeah.
Right? But you're still always learning.
Yeah.
And that's what I love about Jesus. You know, he took the time to be with the people.
Yeah.
You think about the woman that had the issue of blood, and she's pushing through the crowd. And I've been in football games where you have 60,000 and people are brushing up against you. But you know, if somebody touched you in a different way,
yeah,
all those people. And you know, this lady, if I could just touch the hem of her garment, that's all. I'll be made whole. And she's pushing through the crowd, and she touched me. Jesus said, "Who touched me?" And the disciples, I'm thinking, "Who touched me? There's all these people." No, you understand. It's different. Virtue went out of me. Healing power went out of me. It was a lot different.
Yes.
And Jesus turned around and brought, and the woman's just down there. You can just see, she's probably just crying. You know, it was me. And she just bared her heart to what was going on. Thy faith has made you whole. Because you pressed through.
Right.
You went through the crowd. They're not stopping me. We're going.
Yeah.
We're
going to
go. They ain't shouldn't nobody let nobody keep you from getting to Jesus.
Amen.
Nobody.
Right.
Whatever it takes. Jesus. That's right. Amen. That's awesome. That's awesome. Yes. Yep. God directs your steps. He directs your steps. You know, he can tell you to go right, go left, go straight. He can tell you all that. He can get the right two people together. And that's what, just by listening to what God has to say. And sometimes sometimes it gets a little frustrated because why am I doing this? Well, sometimes we got to get away from the why and just say praise God. You know, just start praising him. We ask God a lot of questions. There's nothing wrong. But why are you doing this? Just trust me. Just trust me. I know what I'm doing. I got this. All right, anyone else? Yeah? Now, can we go ahead and yes, in the back.
Right. But you know, God gave him the choice. He told the family he had the choice to be healed.
Mm.
And
Yep, thank you. Well, we'd like to stand up, everybody to stand up. We're going to go to prayer. God, we know you're good. We know that you are a mighty God. We know that you are wonderful, our counselor, our Prince of Peace. We know that in those situations that are difficult, you are still there. Lord, we are tattooed on your hands. That's how close we are to you. And it's all about you, Lord. In the beginning, God, hallelujah. You are the great I am. Lord, you can do what others say can't be done. If it wasn't for you, Lord, where would we be? Lord, we thank you for touching us, changing our lives. Lord, we thank you for getting us up this morning. Father God, we thank you for our children and our grandchildren. Lord, we thank you for our health and our strength. Lord, we thank you for our jobs and our homes and our clothes. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. Lord, we thank you for the paths we cross with other people that we can tell them, you know what? Jesus loves you. Jesus has a plan for your life. Father God, we thank you that, Lord, at night, Lord, we can close our day and celebrate all the blessings because daily you load us our day with benefits, daily. And our mercies are new every morning. Father God, oh Lord, as Psalms 34:1 says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Lord, let us get away from complaining and start proclaiming your goodness. Because God, you are so good. You are mighty God. Let's think about all the blessings. All the dreams that you put in our hearts that, hallelujah, they're on the way to coming. Sometimes it takes a lot of years, but we're not going to lose hope because the Bible says, hope thou in God. And that's what we're going to do. Our hope and our strength lies in you because we've never seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging bread. Hallelujah. As Paul said, this one thing I do, forgetting those things that are behind me and reaching forth. I'm reaching forth to you every day. Because no, God, without you, because it's you that have changed our lives. You did it all 2,000 years ago for us. You made our heart new. You created in us a clean heart. And Lord, let us live holy in reverence for what you did for us.
Yes, Lord.
Let us not forget that. Let us never forget what you've done for us.
Yes, Lord.
Never forget what you're going to do, that you're in the process of doing. God, we thank you and we ask you to put your arms around everybody in this congregation. Like Zephaniah says, you're going to rejoice over us with singing.
Yes, Lord.
You love us that much. And your arms are still outstretched. Come to me, come to me, come to me. I am the Lord your God that healeth. I am the Lord thy God that can provide a way when there's no way. Father God, we ask you to be with us in this service today. Lord, that everybody will know that Jesus Christ is here today. He's here to change lives. Hallelujah. He's here for healing and strength and deliverance, whatever it may be in financial areas. Whatever it may be, whatever needs you have, your needs can be met in Jesus Christ. And Lord, we thank you for this privilege. It's a privilege to come to you in prayer. It's a privilege to bring everything, all of our cares. The Bible said, cast all your cares upon you.
Yes, Lord.
And we're going to do it today. And Lord, as we go throughout this service, make your presence felt today. Because without you, but with you, we can do all things. And we thank you in your wonderful holy name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Okay. All right, we're going to speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ, every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. May be seated. Don and John, come up. Take the offering, please. Don, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to be here today. We just praise Your name. We see Your hand in so many things in our lives, Lord. We just pray that You bless this offering, bless this service. May we all get what we need from this service. We ask it all in the name that is above every name, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Brother Tim. He's an awesome man of God. He had a 5 minutes notice to open service, and God just flows through him. I just love it. I appreciate his heart. I appreciate his openness, and I appreciate his readiness, just as all of us, as we leave this place, being prepared to meet anyone at any given time to minister unto them. We're all called to be kings and priests. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. 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 Continue to pray for two more vocalists. Pray for Roberto and for Peter. They're facing some issues right now. And Jody is stuck at a softball field with her daughter. So be with them right now. And still looking for two altos, an alto and a soprano. So anyway, as the Lord leads, okay? In the meantime, let's worship Him,
yes,
for He is worthy of our praise.
Stir up the flame, keep it alive, even a blaze on the inside. Come have Your way, rise in this place, consume our hearts for Your name's sake. Come receive Holy Spirit from above. Holy Spirit, fall upon us, breathe on us. Holy Spirit from above, Holy Spirit, fall upon us. Look on their threats, stretch out Your hand. Come and shake this place, give us boldness. We lift up our voice, as one we will shout, Your kingdom come, Your will be done. Come receive Holy Spirit from above. Holy Spirit, fall upon us, breathe on us. Holy Spirit from above. Holy Spirit, fall upon us. Come Lord, let your fire fall. We are in need of you. Our hearts are longing for your presence. Lord, let your fire fall. We are in need of you. Our hearts are longing for your presence. Lord, let your fire fall. We are in need of you. Our hearts are longing for your presence. Lord, let your fire fall. We are in need of you. Our hearts are longing for your presence. Come receive, Holy Spirit from above. Holy Spirit, fall upon us. Breathe on us. Holy Spirit from above. Holy Spirit, fall upon us. Come receive, Holy Spirit from above. Holy Spirit, fall upon us.
Let's spend time ministering unto the Lord this morning. He is worthy of our praise, church. Oh, come let us adore him. Come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. Friday night we came together, house of prayer, for one thing, to learn how to release the kingdom of God to a lost and dying world. That was our only agenda. Remember back in the book of Acts, when the Holy Ghost fell on the day of Pentecost, they didn't stay inside the building and have a Holy Ghost party and just keep it within themselves. They went out into the streets and the highways and the byways. And as they went out, thousands came to the Lord. I haven't seen that lately. I see one-on-one. I see individual things going on, but I don't see masses of people. As this body goes forth into the streets, I pray, being filled with the Holy Spirit and the gift that the Lord has placed in you after you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I dare you, go beyond these walls and release it. Release it. There's an awakening upon this nation. It's starting to waken up, but it's not there yet, church. Mostly because the church is asleep. If you look deep into the meaning of the word Iowa, it's called Sleepy One. It's time for Iowa to wake up. We're in the heartland of this nation, and this nation needs a heart renewal. It needs a heart started again. Let the heartland change this nation and go beyond into this world. For you are holy, Lord. You are holy, Lord. You are holy, Lord. You are holy, Lord.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
It's the name of Jesus. It's the name of Jesus.
There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain. To break every chain.
Oh, church, there's an army. There's an army rising up. Will we be part of that army, or will we sit by the sidelines and watch? I say, let's go.
Yes.
Let's go where the Lord leads.
Hallelujah.
Let's follow after him, and let's walk and march and tramp in victory.
Oh, Jesus.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up.
To break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain. To break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain. Oh, we believe. Oh, but you're awesome. Living a life led by your Holy Spirit, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the liberty and the freedom that comes knowing you. I thank you, Lord, that you have broken the chains, that we are free. Whoever you set free is free indeed. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Glory ever to your name.
Let's walk and live in freedom.
You are worthy, Lord. Worthy, Lord. Ever be proclaimed. Worthy, Lord. Worthy, Lord, from the mountaintops, Lord, in the valleys, Lord, your name is to be praised. As we gather with the angels and the 24 elders around your throne, the crown of life we cast at your feet, worthy to be praised. and at your feet they bend their knee. All creatures on the earth below,
come on, worship him.
Bow before you.
Worship him, church, the rocks will cry out. He said it, not me. I'm just repeating what he said.
Yeah.
It might be a little bit loud in here this morning. But I guarantee you the decibel rating at some of the stadiums around here and some of the football games is more. And I love the Lord, and I know I'm not the most gifted, but he said, make a joyful noise.
Yes.
Just make a joyful noise. Because there's no one I want to worship more than him, Jesus, our King. For he is worthy. He is worthy.
There is no one, no one like you. Wonderful God, you are amazing. You created your people to sing. Sing of your love and endless mercy.
When she had a chance to testify, I saw the Lord in the back seat of my Uber car. I saw the Lord at work when I got to share my ear and show that he cares. I saw the Lord as the testimonies were shared. I saw the Lord as my granddaughter reached out for my hand to pull me into her fun tunnel with her. I saw the Lord as I looked out my window and saw the flowers in bloom and the birds flying in all of creation. God's kingdom is being revealed in us every day, all over this place. He preached that we need to be more aware that God's working around us all the time. And because we know him, we're a part of that work every day. I know this is a little unusual, but he wants to do a new thing. He wants us to step out in the gifts that he's given us. He wants us to be bold and to stand in confidence that our daddy has already done this. It's not about us. It's all about him. He said to go back to his word. as though you'd never heard it ever preached before. Read each word and each line as though the first time. Let the Spirit be your guide, 'cause it's all about Him. It's all about Him and His grace. All of His promises are true. They're given to you. We all just reach out and receive. It's not about religion or anything we do. We need only to believe that it's all about Him. It's all about Him and His grace. So go back to His word as though you'd never heard it ever preached before. Read each word and each line as though the first time. Let the Spirit be your guide, 'cause it's all about Him. It's all about Him and His grace.
That was a song that the Lord just gave Tammy. Not Amazing Grace, obviously, but the one prior to that. So, you know, God.
Sorry, that's me.
Oh. Thought I'd been shot. Just waiting for the pain.
I'm a little excited.
Yeah. God is good. Amen. And He wants to lead all of us and guide us. He wants us to know who we really are in Him, because without that, we can't do anything. Without that, we're stuck with ourselves, and if we're honest with ourselves, we know that that doesn't work real well. God has a special plan for each of our lives, and in order for that plan to be realized, we have to see ourselves the way He sees us. Spotless, without blemish, the righteousness of God in Christ. And that's tough to do when you look in the mirror and you see something else, or when your life doesn't totally reflect the righteousness of God. Because as humans, we know we fail on a regular basis. But that's why we need a Savior. And that's why Jesus came. That person, Jesus, is grace. Grace is a person. Just as God is love, God is grace. And it's because of that that we all have hope, not in this world only, but in the next to come, praise God. So God is an awesome God. Amen. And I want us to begin to this morning with Zechariah chapter 9, and we'll read verses 16 and 17. Zechariah 9, verses 16 and 17. You know, some of you may not realize this, that I could have been, you know, you all know what Mensa is. You know, it's the organization for geniuses, people with extremely high IQs. Well, I could have been a member of that if I'd just been smarter. So, you know, don't give up. Well, anything can happen, praise the Lord. So, the Lord their God shall save them in that day as the flock of his people, for they shall be as the stones of a crown, lifted up as an ensign upon his land. For how great is his goodness, how great is his beauty. Corn shall make the young men cheerful, and new wine the maids. Praise the Lord. So, God says that we are stones of a crown, lifted up as an ensign in this world. Now, I don't know how many of you see yourselves that way. I rarely see myself as a precious stone, stubble, rocks, and so forth, but God sees me differently, and he sees you differently. And it's that revelation, it's that understanding of Christ in us and how we have become new creatures in Christ that can change everything, not only for our lives personally, but for the lives that we come into contact with. You know, I don't know how many of y'all spend much time on elevators, but I was thinking the other day, whenever I'm down at the hospitals, all you got elevators. In fact, a couple of them, they've got elevators, and you got to go clear across the hospital to get on another elevator to go to where it is you're trying to get to. And hotels, every time we're in a hotel, there's an elevator you got to get on, or in some of the office buildings downtown. And have you ever noticed how that people are weird in elevators? I mean, maybe it's just me, but nobody makes eye contact. It's like, you know, nobody wants to acknowledge that they're seeing or being seen. And it's strange. It's like Tammy and Dan's granddaughter, Lydia, you know, I don't know what I'd done to her. I suppose, you know, just take a look here, and that maybe might scare little kids. But with her, wherever I get close to her, she turns the other way, like I'm not there. You know, I can't see him, then he can't see me. And that's kind of the experience that I've noticed in elevators. So in a moment of forced intimacy, we pretend that we're not even there. Praise the Lord. We stare at the ceiling. You know, we look at our shoes. We watch the numbers light up as if, you know, something's going to happen on that panel as we go floor to floor. And I guess what I'm saying is what you believe about you shapes the way we interpret our experiences and our beliefs. Not only about our relationships with one another, but about our relationship with God. So let's look in John chapter 5. And I want to read a fairly lengthy verse of scripture here, just chapter 5, verses 8 through 16. John 5, 8 through 16. Praise the Lord. And Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed, and walk. And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walked. And on the same day was Sabbath. And the Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, It's the Sabbath day. It's not lawful for you to be carrying your bed. Pardon my paraphrasing here, but he answered them, He that made me whole, the same said unto me, Take up thy bed and walk. Then asked they him, What man is that which said unto thee, Take up thy bed and walk? And he said, That was healed. He that was healed wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, Behold, thou art made whole, sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him because he had done these things on the Sabbath day. Now, two chapters later, Jesus explains this. So let's go to John chapter 7, and I want to read verses 15 to 18. And the Jews marveled, saying, How knoweth this man letters, having not never learned? Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory, but he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. Drop down to verses 23 and 24, Mike. If a man on the Sabbath day, now he had just talked about the law of Moses and how that the priest circumcised as a ritual or a rite into the Jewish faith, and it's done, as a child. So if a man on the Sabbath day receives circumcision, that the law of Moses should not be broken. In other words, the law had to be fulfilled. You had to be circumcised. And he's saying, they did that on the Sabbath. Are you angry at me because I have made a man every whit whole on the Sabbath day? So he's saying, if you know, you're okay with doing some things on the Sabbath, and work, that's a work. That's breaking the law. And he says, you're okay with that because it's you that's doing it. But now you want to, and that's just a symbolic thing. But here I'm doing something on the Sabbath day, and he says, and you want to kill me for this. Judge not according to the appearance, but judge righteous judgment. You know, it's really easy as Christians, and most of us have experienced this in our, life as believers. And that is that Christianity has had a kind of a bad attitude. Amen. By judging people based on the way they look, the way they act, where they go, what they do. Amen? Rather than judging righteously, which is, if they're a believer, they are the righteousness of God in Christ, even if I don't like what it is they're doing. Exactly. Even if they don't like what I'm doing. Exactly. This isn't about our outward thing. This is about what Christ has done in us. Now, I'm not saying we should be heathens and crazy and just, anything goes, but I'm saying, hey, we're human. Yes. And if you remember the first scripture I read, he's talking about wine. This ought to be like, I'm going to make you a crown, a jewel in the crown. And he said, for you, you're going to drink the wine and the corn's going to make you happy. Now, I don't know if that's moonshine or cornbread. I don't care. I just know that this is God's plan. This is what God says, and we focus and major on things that are not major things to God. Yeah. They're major to religion, but they're not major to our relationship with God. Amen. God is love. Yeah. And I'm not condoning, drunkenness or anything. I mean, just please don't. I'm not going to try to qualify this. I'm just saying things that we make big deals out of, yeah. God isn't that freaked out about.
Exactly.
We make a big deal out of it because it fits our particular denominational, doctrinal, religious kind of ways of thinking. Jesus never came to bring us a religion.
Amen.
He came to fulfill the demands of the religion that was in existence at the time so that we could be set free from the law, so that we could live in liberty based on this grace of God, so that we could have a relationship with God, not based on how good I am, but on how good He is. So my relationship with God now is no longer predetermined by my behavior. It is established already in the behavior of Jesus Christ. I just believe, and therefore I receive. I receive the goodness of God, the blessings of God. I can believe that God's going to heal. I can believe that God's going to deliver. I can believe that God's going to prosper, not because I'm doing everything perfectly, because I know I won't do it perfectly, even though I may try at times, I'm going to fail. And if my expectation of blessing and breakthrough is based on me, then I'm always going to be living this way.
Exactly.
Sometimes I get a blessing, sometimes I'm not going to get one because I'm not expecting a blessing when I'm not doing everything I'm supposed to be doing perfectly. But if I can see myself the way God sees me, this new creature in Christ, this jewel in His crown, then I can expect that God is going to bless me all the time when I'm really doing good and when I'm not doing so good, because He's going to bless me because of His goodness, because of His abundance, because of who He is. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. He is a good God.
Amen.
And He has declared us to be good people.
Uh-huh.
even when we're not so good. We are the blessed. We are the beloved. We are in Him. So what is it that God's after? He's after the healing of the whole person. Not just a part, not just a physical thing, not just an emotional thing. The whole human. He wants us to be completely healed and whole. So that we can come in and share. You know, the testimonies I know sometimes, you know, you go, oh my God, come on. Let's move on here with this. But the truth is, we are made overcomers by the word of our testimony and by the blood of the Lamb. Our testimony is just saying, hey, I know I got problems. I got issues. But God's bigger than the problem. God can take care of it. And that's what we hear. No matter what the testimony is, it still goes back to the, look, I'm trying to get the focus off of me and onto Him. I'm trying to not focus on my problem and my issues. I'm trying to get focused on Him, and the issues will then take care of themselves. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Yeah. His righteousness, not my righteousness. The righteousness He gives me. And all these things then be added to you. Yeah. All the things that we are struggling with all the time are free gifts if we just understand who we are in Christ. That's the challenge that we have. Amen. That's the faith that God looks for. Amen. Luke chapter 19, verses 9 and 10. And Jesus said unto him, this day is salvation come to this house, forasmuch as he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which is lost. That is the purpose of Jesus. That's why he came. He didn't come to establish a new religion, a different religion. He came to seek and to save the lost. He's still doing it. That's still his mission. Amen? All right, let's look at this in Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. I mean, if we get comfortable with God, you can be comfortable with anybody. Amen? Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It's henceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Praise the Lord. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass away, or pass one jot or one tittle, shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Let me remind you now that Jesus is speaking this, and this is under the law. The law is still in effect. He has not died. He has not been crucified. He hasn't been raised from the dead. We're not into the dispensation of grace. We're still struggling, amen, with the law. So that's what he's talking about. Same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter the kingdom of heaven. Praise God. Now what he's saying is, they're claiming, the scribes and the Pharisees are claiming that they keep all of the 600 plus laws perfectly, and that's why you have to look to them, and they're going to give you the directions and how to go and how to be, and you got to do all this stuff all the time, not to mention all the daily sacrifices that are going on and so forth. And Jesus just, you know, rips this whole thing right out of their game plan by saying, look, I know you think that the scribes and the Pharisees are these great religious people that are keeping all the rules. But I'm telling you, unless your righteousness is greater than theirs, you're not going to get into the kingdom. What he's saying is the same thing he tells us in his message on the Mount you want to call it that, where he says, you know, you said that you've heard in the law that thou shalt not kill. I'm telling you, if you hate somebody, you're guilty. You've heard it said, thou shalt not commit adultery. I'm saying if you looked on a woman and just had it go through your head, you're as guilty as if you had committed the crime. And what he's doing is setting the bar to the place where nobody can keep this. It was never meant to be kept. It was meant to bring us to a place where we realize we need a Savior.
Yes.
We can't do this. Only Jesus was able to fulfill the law. The only person that ever did or ever could. You don't have to feel guilty because you can't keep the law perfectly. You need to feel guilty if you don't have sense enough to trust in the one who did, because he is the one that redeems us and puts us in right standing with God. Doesn't mean we don't want to live moral and good lives. It just means that even when we fail, we have an advocate with the Father. We have somebody that has come between our failure and his demand. Satisfied the law, satisfied the demands of a holy God, and made us holy because he is holy.
Yes.
Praise God. No amount of personal righteousness can accomplish what God's already done in Jesus. What is it that's important here? Man's opinion or God's? Grace reigns in the kingdom of God. Grace rules in the kingdom. Psalm 16 and 3. But to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent in whom is all my delight. That's us. Yeah. Saints, excellent. Delighted in God's eyes. Delightful in God's eyes.
Amen.
I don't normally think of myself that way, but I'm glad God does.
Yes.
You know, remember my metaphor of the elevator. You know, I mean, this is what God is trying to get us to understand. Be comfortable.
Yes.
Relax. You don't have to be awkward. You can be comfortable in any situation because this is how I see you. I don't care how the other people on the elevator see you. I see you as excellent. I see you as delightful.
Yes.
I know it's counterintuitive because we know ourselves so well. But believe me, no matter how well you know you, God knows you better. He knew you before you were ever dreamed of by your parents. Before you were ever conceived, he knew you. And he has declared you righteous in him. Perfect. Established. One with God. Psalms 119, verses 39 through 42. Psalms 119, 39 through 42. I'm telling you that if we need an awakening, the awakening we need is to who we are in Christ. And that'll not only change you, but it'll change all of your relationships.
Exactly.
Especially your relationship with God. Because you'll never fear him again. I'm not saying we shouldn't be awed by God. But I'm talking not fear like Adam and Eve had, that they had to run and hide because they had failed. But a fear that come boldly to the throne of grace. He's made his love available to us. We are the beloved. Christ. Amen. Turn away my reproach, which I fear. This is David. How many of you know David had some issues?
Yeah.
An adulterer, a murderer, many other times when he broke God's commands, numbering the people. There's a whole litany of things that he did that failed God, and yet he was a man after God's heart. Why? Because he believed in God's mercy. He knew God was holy, but he knew that God also was merciful. And he always approached him from that perspective. So he says, turn away my reproach, which I fear, for the judgments are good. Behold, I have longed after thy precepts. Quicken me in thy righteousness. Let thy mercies come also unto me, O Lord, even thy salvation according to thy word. So shall I have wherewith to answer him that reproacheth me, for I trust in thy word. It's just kind of another way of saying Isaiah 54's last verse, no weapon formed against you will prosper, and every tongue that rises in judgment of you, you have the power to condemn because you are a child of God.
Yes.
And your righteousness is of him.
Yes.
You don't ever have to be intimidated.
No.
You don't have to be intimidated for any reason. IQ, hair color, number of teeth, praise the Lord. Anything, physical, emotional, you don't have to be intimidated. You are accepted in God. David had this. David said this, and I'll go back to my little side on Mensa. I'm not a Mensa. I'm not a genius. But I can claim the same thing David did, that I'm smarter, I'm wiser than all my teachers. Why? Because I have the mind of Christ if I will use it. If I will think in those terms, I have the ability to do things that the highest educated people can't. How many people that you may know that have degrees? And I don't mean like a thermometer, I mean degrees, you know, PhDs and so forth, who have no clue about God. And what they may know about God, they refuse to believe. And he takes the foolishness of this world to confound the wise, and he brings the wisdom of the world to nothing. Foolishness. You might be surprised to know you know a whole lot more than many, many college professors, doctors, lawyers. Praise the Lord. What's really influencing me? Fear of man or trust in God? The fear of man is a snare, the Bible says. It's a trap. It's a trap to keep you from ever being everything you're supposed to be, from ever developing into all that God wants you to be. Let's look at Revelation chapter 19, verse 11, Mike. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. He's not judging in anger. He's judging based on righteousness. You're either the righteousness of God in Christ, or you're lost. You're not judged because of your behavior. You're judged because of the choice you make to either accept him and his righteousness, or go about trying to produce your own righteousness and fail. He's not angry. He's angry at sin, but he's not angry at people. He's never been angry at people. He loves humanity. He created it. He just hates the sin because it destroys the potential for every living human being. It keeps us from being in the image of God. And it's about faith. It's about believing that we are who he says we are. That's number one. You can't believe for healing. You can't believe for deliverance. You can't believe for financial breakthroughs if you don't believe that God has accepted you. Because now it's all about you again. And you'll fail, and then you'll expect something bad's going to happen. Or at least nothing good is going to happen. But if you see yourself the way God has defined you, then you can expect every day to be like going to Grandpa's house. Goodies. Toys. He's going to love me even when I act up. Amen. That's Jesus said, this is the way I want you to approach him. Abba. Daddy. I know under the old covenant was our Father who art in heaven. I use those same terms. I talked about this a week ago. But the truth is, he wants to relate to us and us to relate to him as daddy, yes. As papa.
Amen.
Amen. And sometimes in our religious kind of ways of doing things, we actually push God away and make him some unapproachable deity that we can't even interact with. And yet everything God has done is the opposite. It's about bringing us close to him, making him accessible, amen, and making us understand that we are accepted. So that how else can you have faith that will please God? You know, every generation has its problems when it comes to a revelation of Jesus. I think for us, those of us that are here today, at least, the lack of confidence in good and heroic things. In my generation, I grew up with the Lone Ranger, you know, and Roy Rogers. It was clearly defined, good and evil. White hat, man, it's good. Black hat, not so much. Little Boston Blackie mustaches, look out. It's not Simon Legree, but there's something evil behind that little thing, you know? So that's just the way it was, and it was easy as a kid growing up in the 50s that, I know, this is right, that's wrong. It's obvious. But since then, we've come to celebrate the neurotic. Today, the heroes of most of the novels that you find, movies, they're anti-heroes. They're broken characters. People riddled with addictions and self-doubt. And it's what we have accepted in our times to be the norm. We've come to the place where every story is tainted. Every story is twisted. I know I sound like, well, it's an old man. He's just complaining because they're not all Roy Rogers. But I'm just saying, skepticism has become virtue. It's no wonder we don't trust anybody. Because everything that we see, everything that we read, teaches us not to. John chapter 12, verse 42. Exactly. Superman and Batman, for crying out loud. That's sacrilege. Fighting each other. It's not right. Who knew? I mean, come on. But that's what I'm saying. That's the way the whole generation has gone. To where wrong is right. Right is wrong. Up is down. Down is up. Princes leading servants on horseback. Talks about, you know, in other words, got the wrong guys on the horse. The wrong people are in charge. But that's a message for another day. Praise the Lord. Nevertheless, among the chief rulers, also many believed on him, but because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. So why did Nicodemus visit Jesus at night? The fear of what his peers would do if they found out.
Exactly.
What people think of us is a powerful motivator, whether we want to admit it or not. I like to say, I don't care. But I do. I just have to pretend like I don't care. Because not everybody's going to like you.
Exactly.
Not everybody's going to agree with you. They have a right to be wrong. Let them. You don't have to fix everybody. Just trust God. Trust the Lord. Any of us go through an entire day being completely true to ourselves? Do we even know the true us? Do I even know how to be completely true to me every day? Is there a true us? I mean, is there a true me? Or is it just whatever the circumstance demands or requires or position I find myself in, do I try to adjust me to that situation? Am I making sense?
Yes.
Amen. Whether it's fear, whether it's uncertainty, or deception, it just seems natural that we shape ourselves according to the moment. Normally, we think of integrity as, you know, the ability to resist temptation by self-discipline. I can tell you, if that's how you operate in integrity, you won't have a whole lot of integrity. Because you will give. You'll begin to yield. And I mean, like I'm saying, you know, we were a part of a church when I first was saved that was a holiness church. It was very rigid, very strict, very demanding. No televisions, you know, all this kind of stuff. It was years ago, but it was the way it was. And I remember thinking, I wonder, you know, what they did, what was wrong before they had TV. Well, it was radio. But now radio was okay at this point because we had TV. And then we went so far as this is the Pharisee of Pharisees, but it's what religion creates. So we went to having monitors, we called them, which was simply a computer monitor that you could hook up a VCR or back in those days, whatever they were, VHS or something, about this big, shove it in there with both hands. So you could see movies, you could watch movies, you could see the same thing that was on TV, just you didn't have commercials.
Yeah.
I mean, who wouldn't want that? But the TV was bad. Monitor was okay. I mean, you see these holiness people lined up with their buns and all their get up at the video stores in droves. They wouldn't have a TV near that. Get that devil's box out of here, you know. I gave mine to a neighbor.
I didn't care if he went to hell. You know, I didn't want to go. So I gave my TV to him. I thought, what the hell, he's going there anyway. So just watch TV on the way. But I'm saying we make hypocrites out of ourselves by listening to religion instead of listening to God, by trying to judge ourselves among ourselves instead of just accepting who God has declared us to be. And it makes us uncomfortable. How many of you know when you're keeping something you know isn't just it just isn't right? It's not comfortable. You're always feeling like you gotta act a certain way or do a certain thing to cover, you know? God wants us to live our life freely, at peace. You know, even when we screw up, we can feel like it's okay, God still loves me. Amen? I don't have to hide. I don't have to pretend. I don't have to fake this and dress a certain way and look a certain way in order for people to see, oh, there's a religious person. You don't know. Inside there is dead men's bones. Make white, you know, the outside and inside, it's dead. Right. No spirit, nothing really happening. So every child is born into this world without confidence in the goodness of God. They have to be taught. There's an awareness of something beyond themselves. God said he put eternity into everyone, but children have to be taught the goodness of God. And that's why, you know, we've talked about this before too. If you had a father who was just not loving and not very kind or whatever, it's more difficult for you then to relate to God as daddy. You never had a daddy. You had a father. You had a disciplinarian. I'm not saying he didn't love you. I'm just saying he wasn't able to interact on an emotional level, on a way that would make you feel secure in his love, not in your behavior. And that's what God's trying to get us to understand. You've had earthly fathers, and they may correct you certain ways and so on and so forth, but I love you. I want to love you. The chastening that I give is to bless you, not to punish you, to help you to understand who I am and how I relate to you. This lack of confidence in the goodness of God, it's what we got from Adam and Eve.
Right.
That's why they were hiding. They were afraid. We're born into this world doubting God. And we're awkward with each other because we're awkward with ourselves. And we're awkward with ourselves because we're awkward with God. We're not comfortable. Romans chapter 14 and verse 23. That's why elevators are freaky, because it's forced intimacy, and all of a sudden you got to confront all of that or pretend you're not there or pretend they're not there. Amen? If therefore the whole church become together into one place and all speak with tongues and there come in those that are unlearned or unbelievers, will it not say that you're mad? That's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking at Romans chapter 14, verse 23. That'll be good. Praise the Lord. He that doubteth is damned. Damned if he eat. Because he eateth not of faith. For whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Whatever isn't born out of confidence in God is sin. Praise the Lord. Whatever isn't born out of confidence in God is sin. Whatever we do with a lack of confidence in God, God sees that as sin. Now don't get freaked out and think you're going to die. That's why we've got grace. But the purpose is that we do everything, and all that we do with a confidence that God loves me, that God's not going to punish me. God's going to bless me.
Yes.
So one man may have a drink of wine or a drink before dinner or a beer at the pizza place or something, and the next person sees that, that's sin. Well, it isn't to him if he isn't guilty for it, if he feels like it's okay with God. I'm not talking about stumbling, falling down, throwing up on yourself drunk. I'm talking about having a drink or this or that or whatever. I'm not encouraging that. I'm just saying These are the things that we want to major on. And God is saying, look, if you have confidence in my love for you, you don't have to feel guilty and ashamed and freaked out over every little thing that you do. You don't have to second guess everything. And you don't have to let some man be your judge. That's a trap. If we ever get to the place where we're comfortable in our relationship with God, then I'm comfortable with me. Now I can be comfortable with you. If I'm all hung up with my neurosis and my problems, you do not want to be my buddy. You don't want a neurotic for your best friend because they'll make you crazy. Amen. That's why God knows that it starts with Him, with our confidence in Him, our comfortableness with Him. Come boldly to the throne of grace. Abba, Daddy, so that I can then be comfortable with me, even with my faults, even with my failures, because then I can be comfortable with you. Then I won't be looking at you and seeing the speck in your eye through the beam that's in mine. Paul said, I want to know nothing except Christ and Him crucified. I don't want to see anything but Jesus, regardless of what I see. That's the only way it'll work. Whatever isn't born out of confidence in God is sin. Our uncomfortableness is lack of confidence in God. I didn't make John mad. He's got to go to work, praise the Lord. Actually, he's going to a baby shower, but our uncomfortableness is a lack of confidence. It's the result of fear. Everything is covered by grace. God's promise to us is total forgiveness, total acceptance. We have the life of Jesus living in us. That's the proof that we are righteous, that we are holy, or God could not dwell in a place that's not holy. He has cleansed us and made us whole so that He can dwell not only with us, but in us. You've got to ground yourself in God's opinion, not man's experience. Accept the truth as told by God. Right here. Let God be true and every man a liar. Even you. Even yourself. Let me read this to you. Romans 8, verses 1 and 2. This is from the Message Bible, though. You know, typically we would read it, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit, so on and so forth. That's the scripture, but here's what it says in the Message Bible. With the arrival of Jesus, the Messiah, that fateful dilemma is resolved. What fateful dilemma? The dilemma that Paul talks about all through Romans 7, which is the harder I try, the better to be, the worse I am. I want to do right, but I screw up. I have the right thoughts about doing things, but I end up doing something else. I know to keep my mouth shut, but I don't. I create problems, right? So, here's what he says. With the arrival of Jesus the Messiah, that fateful dilemma is resolved. Those who enter into Christ's being here for us, enter into Christ's being here for us, no longer have to live under continuous, low-lying black clouds. A new power is in operation. The Spirit of life in Christ, like a strong wind, has magnificently cleared the air, freeing you from a fated lifetime of brutal tyranny at the hands of sin and death. That's what Jesus has done. Amen? Our life is an elevator ride, but it doesn't have to be awkward and uncomfortable. It's meant to be exciting. It's meant to be victorious. It's meant to be glorious. Zechariah 9, and we'll wrap up here with this. Zechariah 9 and verses 12 through 17. Zechariah 9, 12 through 17. Turn you to the stronghold, ye prisoners of hope. Even today do I declare that I will render double unto thee. When I have bent Judah for me, filled the bow with Ephraim, and raised up thy sons, O Zion, against thy sons, O Greece, and made thee as the sword of a mighty man. And the Lord shall be seen over them, and his arrow shall go forth as the lightning, and the Lord God shall blow the trumpet and shall go with whirlwinds of the south. The Lord of hosts shall defend them, and they shall devour and subdue with sling stones. And they shall drink and make a noise as through wine, and they shall be filled like bowls and as the corners of the altar. And the Lord their God shall save them in that day as the flock of his people, for they shall be as the stones of a crown, lifted up as an ensign upon his land. For how great is his goodness, and how great is his beauty. Corn shall make the young men cheerful, and new wine the maids. We are the glorious ones in whom God is delighted.
Thank you, Lord.
And that's worth celebrating.
Yes.
That's the good news. That'll set you free, and that'll make an elevator ride fun. Give the Lord a hand clap this morning, would you? Amen, amen. God bless all of you. Thank you, visitors, for being here. Hope you'll come back and be with us again. God bless you. Have a great week. And trust God. He's a good one. Amen. You're dismissed in Jesus' name. Shake hands with one another. Tell them, seem good to me.